long as the physical brain is conditioning our cognitive activity, our thoughts appear haphazard and confused. One thought begins and then breaks off, driven from the scene by a second thought. If we really examine a conversation between two people and who listen to it, or if we observe ourselves carefully, we will get an idea of the rule of the quality of these thoughts. As long as we are applying ourselves to tasks in a sense perceptible world, our confused train of thought is always straightened out by the actual matter at hand. Regardless of how. 8. 186 Theosophy. Confused I am in my thinking. Daily life forces me to conform to the laws of reality in my actions. For example, I may have an extremely haphazard idea of how a city is laid out, but if I want to get around to it, I have to adapt to how things really are. Mechanics may come into the shop with their heads full of a jungle of all kinds of ideas, but the laws governing how their machines work and how they should adopt appropriate working procedures. In the sense perceptible world, hard facts act as a constant for every star thinking. If I have the wrong idea about some physical phenomenon such as the story of a plant, reality confronts me and sets my thinking straight. In relationship to higher areas of existence, however, things are very different. These realms disclose themselves to me only when I approach them with my thinking already strictly disciplined. In this case, if my thinking does not provide the correct impulse, if I am not my own confident guide, I will not find the right way to go. The spiritual laws prevailing here have not condensed to the point of physical perceptibility and therefore do not impose the same corrective sense that perceptible things do, so I will be able to obey them only if they are related to my own laws, the ones that govern me as a thinking being. As a seeker of knowledge, I must alter my thinking so that it is strictly self-regulated. My thoughts must gradually get out of the habit of running their everyday course and adopt instead the interference of the spiritual world. I must be able to observe myself and disregard and keep things under control. I must not allow one thought to follow another arbitrarily but only. The path to knowledge 187. In accordance with the rigorous standards of the contents of the thought world, the transition from one idea to another must correspond to strict laws of thinking, and I myself as a thinker must stand as a copy of these laws, so to speak. I must eliminate from my train of thought everything not flowing from these laws. If a deeper thought gets in my way, I must put it aside so that it does not disturb the orderly sequence, and if a personal feeling tries to impose a direction on my thoughts that is not supply no forces that could form a basis for spiritual knowledge. Seekers lovers of knowledge cannot consider only what new trees are lead to success for themselves. They must also consider what they have recognized as good. They must willingly submit to the strict law that requires them to renounce all personal arbitrariness and all fruits their actions may have for their own personality. Then they are walking the path of the spiritual world in their own. The path to knowledge 189. Being is permeated by its law. They are free from all sensory constraints. Their spirit being within reach of sensory trappings. This is how they spiritualize themselves, how they make progress toward the spiritual. We cannot question whether it does any good to resolve to obey only the laws of truth when in fact we may be mistaken about what is true. Everything depends on our effort and our attitude, and even people who are mistaken but are aspiring to the truth possess a strength that will set them back on the right track. The very objection that we may be mistaken is in itself destructive disbelief and demonstrates a lack of trust in the power of truth. The point here is that instead of presuming to decide on our goals from our own self-serving point of view, we should submit selflessly to the spirit and allow it to determine our direction for us. Self-serving human volition cannot dictate to the truth. Truth itself must become sovereign in us, filling our whole being and transforming it into a replica of spirit country's eternal law. We must imbue ourselves with these eternal laws in order to let them flow out into life. As seekers of knowledge, we must have our mind as well as our thinking strictly under control. Then, in all humility and without presumption, we become messengers of the world of truth and beauty. We advance to become participants in the spiritual world and release it from one level of development to the next. If we cannot achieve living in the spirit merely by being beholders of it, it has to be experienced. If the laws that are presented here are observed by seekers of knowledge, their inner experience in relation. 10. 190 Theosophy. The spiritual world will assume a completely new form. Instead of having significance only for their own personal life, it will develop into full perceptions of the higher world. Feelings of pleasure and displeasure or joy and pain will grow into soul organs that transmit outer impressions selflessly like physical eyes and ears, which also do not exist for themselves alone. This is how knowledge seekers achieve the calm and secure frame of mind required for research in the spiritual world. A great pleasure that once would have simply made them jump for joy will now lure them to previously unnoticed aspects of their surroundings and will leave them at peace. Within this peace, features of the entities causing the pleasure will be revealed. And on the other hand, pain will no longer simply fill the seekers with distress but will also be able to inform them what qualities belong to the being causing the pain. Desire nothing for themselves but selflessly show the physical person what direction to take, pleasure and pain will lead to full safety on its way. This is the state of inner equanimity that these seekers of knowledge must achieve. When pleasure and pain no longer exist in cult and creating turbulence in our inner life, they begin to function like eyes open to the supersensible world. It is not possible to lose pleasure and pain as sources of information as long as we are dwelling in and on them. Identity to them, they become organs of perception we can use in order to see and to know. It is incorrect to think that a sage must. The path to knowledge 191. Become a dry, sober person incapable of experiencing pleasure or pain. For such a person, pleasure and pain still exist, but when he or she is investigating the spiritual world, these are present in metamorphosed form as eyes and ears. As long as our relationship to the world is a personal one, is only what connects them to our own personality. This, however, is merely their transient aspect. If we pull back from what is transient in ourselves and dwell with our I and our feeling of identity and what is lasting in us, our transient features are transformed and begin to convey the eternal aspects of things to us. This relationship between our own eternal aspect and what is eternal in other things is something seekers must be able to bring about deliberately. Before taking up any other exercises of the sort described here, and also while practicing them, we need to direct our attention to this immortal aspect. Whenever I observe a stone, plant, animal or person, I should be aware that something eternal is expressed there. I should be able to wonder about what is lasting in a transitory stone or a mortal person, what it is that will outlast their transient sense-perceptible manifestation. We must not imagine that if we turn our mind to the eternal like this, it will estrange us from immediate reality and destroy our ordinary capacity for observation and our feeling for everyday affairs. On the contrary, each little glimmer or shade of color, every intonation will remain vividly perceptible too. 11. 192 theosophy. Our senses. Nothing will be lost, but infinite new life will be gained. People who do not know how to observe the smallest detail with their eyes will also never achieve spiritual vision, but only pale and bloodless spots. Everything depends on the attitude we acquire. How far we get will depend on our ability. We only have to do what is right and let the rest develop on its own. To begin with, we must be content with turning our attention to what is lasting. This effort in and of itself will eventually allow us to recognize the eternal. We must wait and see that the future has. It will happen at the right moment if we wait and work. Soon after beginning self-exercises, people notice major inner transformations. They learn to base their estimation of the things important for lasting exclusively on this recognized relationship to something lasting and eternal. They arrive at a new and different assessment of the world and feel differently related to their surroundings.
Possible only for someone who refuses to regard to the spirit that prevails within them. Connection with humanity. This small work begins to indicate the lower Christ in human nature and human evolution.
manifestations of karma, 1910 reincarnation and karma, 1912 life between death and rebirth, 1912 minus 13 between death and rebirth, 1912 minus 13. All works by Rudolf Steiner that are reprints are available from the Anthroposophic Press. RR Core Box 94A-1, Princeton, NY12534. The print complete catalog is published annually. Throughout its print works, right, Rudolf Steiner Library, Room 2 Box 215, IF, NY12075. 200 Theosophy, Index 201, Index.
Thank you.
Also personality chemical properties and mechanistic understanding.